Hello. It's very weird to hear this introduction about yourself of the text you wrote. But my name is Bastian. I work at SysElevn. SysElevn is a managed hosting company, and I mostly work on managed Kubernetes. But today, I want to talk to you about proactive web security. So what can go wrong security-wise in a web application? And what can we do to maybe prevent some of the bad things happening? And thinking about security is really important. Because even the big players, if you look at the news of the last few years, there's tons of security breaches that happened. For example, in 2013-14, at Yahoo, there were 3 billion user accounts compromised. eBay in 2016, 145 million user accounts. Adult Friend Finder in 2016, 412 million user accounts. Sony, also very famously with the PlayStation Store in 2011, 77 million user accounts, and they actually made a loss about $171 million just with the security breach. And probably the worst of all of that is Equifax. I don't know if you heard about that last year. It's a US company. They also had a security incident where the personal information of about 143 million customers was compromised. And personal information there was not only like their email address and something like that, but it was actually their social security number, credit card numbers, financial ratings, all kinds of information, which is really, really bad in terms of identity theft. And there are tons of more of these examples. And hopefully your company is not going to be the next one. And now you're thinking maybe, but I'm small. Like, we have like a couple thousand users. We are not really interesting. Actually, everyone is interesting to attack us as soon as they have users, because there is something of value there. So let's think about the harmful things an attacker can do, and what can we do to prevent them. Okay, I'll stop that with the clicker. One of the disclaimers here, none of these lists that you hear in talks or that you read in blog posts are ever complete, because there's always more. Just for this talk, to keep within like the 45-minute, like to 1-hour time frame, I had to cut out like 30% of the ideas I had for this talk or what I wanted to talk about. So definitely there is more. And also things are changing constantly. There are new attack vectors coming up, new bugs coming up, new vulnerabilities coming up. The same thing is that browser vendors, framework vendors, they're also providing better tools to prevent things from happening. So you have to stay up to date. Also, for this talk, I'm going to cover a lot of different topics. And every one of these topics will start with a quick basic introduction about what the vulnerability is, how you can exploit this, and then I'm going to get very quickly deeper in how to actually prevent things from happening. And I guess most of you, or nearly all of you, will have at least something in the talk that you haven't heard before. I hope at least. So, let's get started and let's get into the mind of a hacker, of an attacker that wants to hack your website. The first thing an attacker may try to do is he may try to get access to your database. And now you're thinking, of course, yeah, you should use authentication, you should use TLS between your web application and the database, and you definitely should not expose your database to the internet. Fun fact, security researchers found out nearly 30,000 MongoDB instances are publicly on the internet. And they don't have any authentication enabled. That's quite bad. And it's not only MongoDB, so I don't want to bash on MongoDB. It's also things like Memcache, Redis, that also doesn't have any authentication, and lots of other things. But MongoDB is especially bad because the default of MongoDB for a long time was to listen publicly on the public network interface and not on localhost. You can just quickly check that as an attacker by just using the Mongo CLI and connecting to the main domain of your website. And maybe to try to prevent that, you, as a developer, can just scan your public IP addresses for open ports. There is a tool called Nmap that is quite nice for that, that you can just run like this, Nmap, and then just your domain name. And it will then trace over all known ports, look if they are open, and also will tell you nicely what it's usually used for. And hopefully the result of your web page will be something like this, that port 80 and port 443 are open for HTTPS and HTTP traffic. These are still two open ports though. And two open ports, you need them, of course, to serve a website, but they are an attack vector. And because of bugs in your software, they couldn't be exploited. A very typical kind of bugs from a security point of view are so-called injection vulnerabilities. Most prominently, SQL injections. Just a quick recap with like very, very stupid pseudocode. Of course, in a normal application, this will become much more complex. So here, I'm getting the user ID from the request, putting it into a query that it should return me one user object, and then probably I'm displaying this to the user. Exploit would be, user ID could also be something like 12 or true. So I'm not getting only the user with the ID 12, but basically all the users. Very simple. What you should do about this is escape the values. Either with the MySQL extension, with this real escape string function, or by using an ORM like Doctrine, where you can use an entity manager to just fetch this, or use prepared statements, where you then have a function where you can put in a query in, and instead of putting like the variable directly in there with concatenation, you just have a placeholder that you let the database fill in there. If you're using such a construct, can I use the? This still works. So if you're using such a construct here, what you also could do is you could put a static code analysis on it. So you could check if a create native query function is used, that the first argument of this function here is actually a static string and not a variable or something that is concatenated where potentially malicious code could be injected there. So you can use things like PHP code sniffer for that. So this is like a very prominent one, and most applications are actually very secure nowadays because of ORMs against SQL injections. But there are more type of injections, and also some of them that I unfortunately ran into at some point. For example, you can also inject things into HTTP requests that your application is doing to other APIs and other services. Let's look at this code. Also, a lot of very simplified. We're using Guzzle to do an HTTP call to api.com, and we're passing an ID there that also somehow comes from the user. Of course, this ID can be not only an integer, but also something like 6 and admin equals true, which maybe in this API returns additional fields that a normal user should not be getting and not be displayed. So also there, when we're doing HTTP requests, we have to escape things either with URL and code, or just with using library features. Like for Guzzle, for example, I can also construct the query string with an array, and then automatically everything gets escaped correctly. Next injection type that is possible is command injection. Again, simplified code. We have a small script that will get a log file, the file name from the outside, and then just put out the file content. First thing I can do is I can pass as a malicious attacker something like this as a query parameter, which will then just delete my whole file system, or at least the files my PHP process has access to, which is not good. So also there, we should escape things. And with commands, we can do this with the escape shell arg function, which is a lot better. There's still a vulnerability in there, which is pass traversals. So if I as an attacker, I pass in this value here, so like /etc/passvd, what will happen then is that very happily the PHP script will print out the passvd file to the user. So we also not only need to escape things, we also need to validate things. Validation could be that we are just limiting the amount of characters we are allowing in the script, with just a regular expression saying, hey, the file that we want to put out should be end with .log and should only have A to Z characters, and or by actually resolving this relative pass to an absolute pass and checking if I'm actually fetching files out of the directory that I'm using, that I want to fetch logs from. Another type of injections, there are a lot of them, would be code injections, when I'm using a function like eval or to evaluate random generated code or create function. I also can just pass values in there. The solution for that could be just not using them, because usually they are not necessary in modern PHP, and you can just write a PHP codesniff or use a static analysis to forbid the usage of create function even in your whole code base, and you should be fine. Another fun one is XML entity injection. XML has a nice feature that if you parse it, it also resolves entities to different to some URLs, and URLs can also be URLs to your local file system. So if you parse this XML file here, the content of the etc parse2d file will be inside here. And then if you parse this, do something with this, and present this again to the user, then you could also compromise local files. This is like a standard XML feature. It's activated by default in PHP with the libxml parser, and you should probably disable it. Good thing is you can disable it globally in the whole PHP script with the libxml disable entity loader function, and then only enable it if you really, really need it. One option where you would only need it is SOAP APIs. And unfortunately, there are still some around there. Most prominently, I think the Google DoubleClick API is written in SOAP or uses SOAP. But I'm probably going to trust Google to not do an XML entity injection on my page. And also, I want to display advertisements, so I actually need this API. So for that API, it's probably fine to use this. And also, this API is over TLS, so I don't have a man-in-the-middle attack. So that's maybe something where I can enable it. Good practice to enable this, maybe write a function that is called dangerously enable XML entity loader or something like this that only for this call to the SOAP API enables this, and the finally block disables it directly again. So these are some of the injection vector attack vectors that are there. If an attacker can't find any injection vulnerabilities, they may, in your code that you wrote, they may try to find vulnerabilities in the libraries that you use or in the frameworks that you use. So you have to keep things up to date there. And of course, this is a very tedious thing to keep everything up to date all the time and also to follow all the security vulnerabilities from mailing lists from all the libraries and frameworks that you're using. To help you with that, you can actually check for known security vulnerabilities in the libraries that are using with tools. For Composer, there is the security checker from Sensio Labs. It's just a CLI tool that you can use where you can put upload or check your Composer log file against a list of versions with known security vulnerabilities. This takes like probably 50 seconds or 2 minutes to include into your CI pipeline. And let's just run this with every commit. That takes also like 1 second to run. And as soon as there is a vulnerability in a variable you use, your build will fail. Awesome. So it also tells you usually to which version you have to upgrade. The same is also possible for NPM, for your front-end dependencies, because they also can have security vulnerabilities. And that's even included in newer NPM versions with NPM audit. The same is also not only true for the PHP code that you're writing or the JavaScript that you're writing or using, but also for your infrastructure. Because security vulnerabilities can not only be in PHP and JavaScript code, but also in your web server, in PHP itself, in your operating system, in any kind of PHP extensions, and all kinds of other packages that you're using. So also there, you have to keep things up to date. And also there, it's good practice to scan for packages with known security vulnerabilities. Tool, just an example that works very well on Ubuntu and Debian servers is called VULS for Vulnerability Scanner, which you also just execute. It checks all installed Debian packages and then gives you also a list of packages that you maybe should be updated because they have known vulnerabilities. If you have done all of that, and you updated all everything, you kept things up to date, great. The next thing an attacker may try to do is not exploit one of these bugs, but just try to take over accounts. Again, starting simple, there is the possibility of man-in-the-middle attacks, because HTTP as a protocol over TCP is plain text, as you may know. So it's very easy to read and modify HTTP requests and responses on the wire, especially on public Wi-Fi's like this one here. So maybe don't do anything over HTTP. And just to simulate that, how easy it is, I can just do this on my laptop, but also use other tools you can do on your system by just using TCP dump. So this command will just listen on all traffic on port 80 on my laptop. And then if I do with curl, just a request to google.com, in TCP dump, I will see the whole request and response. And that's basically like a simplified version, what also is very easy, free to install and download tools you can do on public Wi-Fi as well, and you can also modify things. So it's very, very necessary to encrypt traffic with TLS. Sometimes I hear then, but TLS is slow and expensive. Starting with expensive, it's actually not, it's free. So you can get a free TLS certificate at Let's Encrypt, and it's also fast. So resource for that is go to istlsfastyet.com. The answer is yes, spoiler alert. But it gives you some good tips what you have to configure and actually to make it fast. Because of course, exchanging certificates between the web browser and your server, it takes some time, it takes more round trips. So you have to do things, you can do things that is not done on every request, but only once on the initial session start. You should also check your configuration for that you're, for example, using not ciphers that are already vulnerable and compromised, that your configuration is correct. And a nice website for that is ssllabs.com. You just enter your domain name in there, and then you get a grade, like in school, or at least in American schools. And hopefully it's something like A or A+. If not, it gives you hints what ciphers you should deactivate, because A, no one is using them anymore anyways, and they are broken, or what settings you have to do in Nginx or in Apache to actually make caching of TLS sessions work. Let's go a bit deeper. Let's revisit what actually happens when you enter URL into the address bar of a browser. So this, I have a browser, I enter like some address there and press enter. You notice already I didn't put a protocol in, so I didn't put HTTP or HTTPS in, because that's not what users do, they don't type that. What the browser will do then, of course first it's doing a DNS query to get the IP address for this host name, then it's creating a TCP connection to this IP address, and then it's going to send a GET request to this IP address. And the GET request is going to look like this in curl. And it's going to try this over HTTP unencrypted, because the browser doesn't know yet if the web server behind this supports HTTPS or not. And in a sensible setup, I'm using HTTPS for my website, so I'm actually just redirecting to the HTTPS side. The problem with that is there is a man-in-the-middle attack possible on this initial request. What can we do about this? We can use a browser feature that is called strict transport security. Strict transport security means that just on every HTTP response that I'm sending back from my server, I'm going to also send a response header with it, which is called strict transport security. And this header will tell the browser, please cache and remember for this amount of seconds, max age, that you in this time frame, regardless of what anyone is telling you, always try HTTPS and never HTTP. So the next time the user just enters the domain name without a protocol into the address bar, it will directly try HTTPS and not HTTP. You can actually see this also, for example, in Chrome. If you go to Chrome Net Internals on the HSTS tab, for which domain names Chrome has this all stored. Quite interesting. That still leaves us with the problem that there is the possibility of a man-in-the-middle attack on the very first time that a user comes to this your page. Because the browser doesn't know yet that the server very soon will respond with a strict transport security header. There's also a solution for that, because strict transport security can be preloaded into browsers. In order to do this, we also have to add this preload attribute to the strict transport security header. and max age needs to be long enough. And if we do that, we can, as an admin, go to a web page, hstspreload.org, and then just enter our domain name there. They're going to do some checks. And then a couple of weeks later, your domain name gets merged into a huge list of domain names that only do HTTPS. And this list is actually included in all major browsers. So Chrome, Firefox, Safari, Edge from Microsoft. And a couple months later, probably, on the next browser release, your domain name will be included into a file that is directly in the browser, and requests will only go to HTTPS for this domain name. Of course, you should then be also sure that you never need to switch back to HTTP again, because that's probably a very hard process. So we solved, kind of with that, the man-in-the-middle problem, as long as HTTPS and TLS is not broken. Next thing an attacker could do is just he could try to brute force and guess a password on a login page. Please add rate limits to logins. So if a user from run IP address tried to log in into an account 50 times and 50 times provided the wrong password, or probably 5 times is already enough, show a capture like this. Also, log logins and log login attempts, because you can find out interesting patterns there and maybe block IP addresses, block traffic. Also, you can actually, on a login of a user, also save the device the user logs in with by maybe just setting a cookie. And if a user logs in with a new device that you don't know yet, alert them with an email address. You probably got this already from Google sometimes or from Facebook. And then provide a remote logout possibility where people can then change their password and also say, hey, I wasn't this user here on Chrome 63 on Android from Germany, because on this time it was not even Germany, so maybe I should just lock this session out, change my password, and hope for the best that nothing bad happened. When talking about login security, as an engineer, oftentimes everyone says, yeah, there's also two-factor authentication, which is really great, because you don't only need your passwords, and passwords are insecure anyways, so you also get a text message with a code on your phone that also an attacker would need to in order to log in. The problem is, two-factor authentication is, at least on Google, less than 10% of all Google users use two-factor authentication. And I'm now really interested. Who of you has a GitHub account? Hands up. Who of you uses two-factor authentication on GitHub? This is many or all of you, so that's awesome. So we are probably the 10% of that. Normal users don't do this because it's hard to set up as tedious and it doesn't work. Possible solution for that could be, depending on your product, to use email-only logins. That's, for example, it doesn't work for every product, for every solution, but for some it may work. Good example is Medium, this blogging, news, reading, whatever platform. If you log in at Medium, you get the usual possibilities to log in with Google, Facebook, and Twitter, things you may not want to do, or you can log in with an email address. On the next screen, you enter your email address, click continue, and then you get an email. There is no password involved, and only if you have access to your email address, you can actually log in. For Medium, that's kind of okay. It's probably not good for your online banking solution. It especially works great on mobile phones, where entering passwords is really tedious, especially if you have automatically, randomly generated passwords. So if getting into user accounts directly is not really possible or very, very expensive, what can the attacker next do? They can try to do actions on the user's behalf without direct account takeover. Let's start simple first. Cross-site request forgery, which basically is if I have an endpoint like that on my application, site.com/delete-current-account. The first thing is, which is already kind of good, it only works for my current account, so I can't delete your account because there is no user ID that I just pass in there. It just takes the cookie value from the session and deletes the current account of the logged-in session. So the session cookie is necessary for the request to work. Problem is, the attacker on his site that he controls, where he gets people on just with buying AdWords, sending emails, spam, whatever, they can include an image like this. And the browser will say, hey, there is an image. Let's do a request to it. Oh, for site.com, I also have cookies stored. So I'm going to be helpful and add the cookies to the request, and then your account is deleted. So the browser automatically adds session cookies when the image is fetched. Or the spammer could also just send an email with things like, hey, click on this short link, which will then redirect to this delete account page. Same thing. So first thing is, don't do writing operations on GET requests. Use POST, DELETE, PATCH, PUT, whatever, not GET requests. But that doesn't help, unfortunately. Because the attacker can also do things like that. They can have a POST on their form on their page, and on page load just submit the form. And browsers will just execute this. They will add session cookie, they will add cookies to it. It just works. So that's why you need CSRF tokens. And CSRF tokens basically means you create a token that either you store in a database somewhere and then match the session ID to it and store it as well, or you just encrypt the session ID into the token. Some pseudocode, please don't use this. So as plain text, I'm having a session ID in here, the user ID is some timestamp, I'm encrypting this somehow with some token, and then this token that I'm have encrypted, I have to add to every non-GET request. So for example, either like this as a hidden input field into a form, or for same also for XHR AJAX requests, I also have to add this somewhere to the payload, to the JSON body, whatever. And then if a non-GET request comes into my PHP script, I have to verify that the content of the token, the session ID that is encrypted in there or stored along it, matches the session ID from the cookie. So again, don't use this code. We get the CSRF token out of the body, and then we do some decryption thing. And then if the session ID from the cookie does not match the session ID that I get from the token, I throw an exception and end the request. And because of the cross-origin policy in browsers, the attacker cannot get to the CSRF token that is somewhere in your DOM, like in a hidden info field. They can't access that. So don't use the code, please. Use libraries or frameworks that implement this. For example, Symfony has this. There's a great page for it. That's good. The reason why we need these CSRF tokens is actually because browsers are broken. And they didn't, this whole thing that they just send the cookies whenever I visit is actually kind of like insecure and really bad. Fortunately, browser vendors since a few years are trying to change this now with a feature called same-site cookies. A same-site cookie behaves like a normal cookie, but with the exception that it's only sent to the server in a first-party context. What does it mean? The browser will send the cookie to the server when, for example, I enter the URL in the address bar, because it's a direct navigation from initiated by the user. It will also send the cookie from on a form post that originated from my page and goes to my page, because also this is a first-party context. It will not send cookies, the same-site cookie, if there is a form post that originated from attacker.com and goes to my page. So it's exactly how cookies should have behaved to begin with. There's a lot more information in this blog post. And to use same-site cookies, the good thing is it's very simple. We just have to add an additional attribute to the set cookie header. So just the same-site thing here. This strict thing is also explained in the blog post, so I invite you to read it afterwards. And we just add the same-site thing, and then it's a same-site cookie. So in PHP, we can just set this header manually. And starting with PHP 7.3, also the setCookie function will have a same site attribute there. And on the browser side, can we use this already? Yes, we can. Like 70-something percent of users already use browsers that support same site cookies, which is good. All major browsers support that. On the other hand, 30% use browsers that don't. So we still need CSRF tokens, but chances are maybe in 5-10 years we can get rid of them. And adding same-set cookies now is still a good thing because it's very easy to do, and it gives us an additional layer of security. For example, in cases our framework has a bug, is broken, we are 70% of our users would not be affected by that. But there are other things to do something on behalf of the users. And now comes the very infamous XSS injection things. Again, short, small recap. If we have HTML like this on our page, and this thing here is user-generated comments that comes somewhere from the database. So the user enters something, we store it in a database, display it, this comment somewhere on a web page. Simplified PHP code, like this. And if the comment includes a script tag, then it gets executed. In this case, we send all cookies to attacker.com. So definitely we have to escape content there. In PHP, we can do this with the HTML special chars function, or even better, let's use template libraries like Twig, which automatically escapes this comment, Mustache, which does the same, or let's use front-end frameworks like React.js, Vue, Angular, whatever, that also usually try to get you into the way that does sensible security-wise escape per default. What if we want to allow certain HTML tags in user-generated comments, though? For example, for formatting, links, paragraphs, whatever. There's a library in PHP called HTML Purify, which we can just instantiate, and then we can pass some HTML code in there and say, basically, Purify, hey, purify this, and only tags and attributes that I allow will remain in it. It's also very well tested, very well used. Don't implement this yourself. You're probably going to miss some stuff. Use a sensible library. Or for the thing of comments, just use Markdown. It's probably simpler. The problem with XSS is all of this is great, but it's still very easy to make errors there and create bugs there. And also the big ones, even like probably the gold standard of security in web, like Google, Facebook, they have XSS vulnerabilities and they have them regularly. So chances are you are also going to make those errors. And I did also make those errors. Like, it's very easy to do. So one thing you should do, you should try to limit the impact of these XSS errors that are probably going to happen. First thing is simple. Use cookies that are only accessible, that are not accessible by JavaScript. Again, for a set cookie header, if we add this secure attribute, it tells the browser, okay, send this cookie only over HTTPS. More importantly, this HTTP only attribute tells the browser, please don't make this cookie available by JavaScript, because JavaScript doesn't need the content of the session cookie. In PHP, you can use this with a secure and HTTP only flex as a set cookie method. Next thing you should do is you should add a content security policy. The content security policy is another response header that I just return for every HTTP request in my response. And with that, I can tell the browser, you are only allowed on this page, on this HTML page, to load images, JavaScript, CSS files, or do XHR, AJAX request to these domains that I'm specifying. So I can prevent, if there is a cross-site scripting vulnerability, I can prevent the attacker to send the cookie, as you saw earlier in the demo, to attacker.com, because I'm only allowing to send XHR requests to my page. And if the user, if an attacker tries this, the browser will just not do that. So there's then in the console, you will see some of these errors, refuse to connect to attacker.com because it violates the policy. You can also add reporting then to that by this report URI flag, which then anytime there is a violation of the policy, you will get a request, in this case to /csp errors, and you can just put this somewhere in logs then with the details of what the vulnerability was, and maybe through that you can also detect XSS vulnerabilities. This is good for preventing outside connections, but still an XSS vulnerability means someone can inject JavaScript and do malicious thing on your website for phishing, for whatever reasons. So also what you think could think about is just don't allow inline script tags to be executed. So if you have a script tag and inside of that JavaScript, maybe just don't disallow this to be executed. You can do this as a content security policy. The problem is oftentimes you have to do this because you have to instantiate your front-end framework, you have to pass in some data there, so you need inline JavaScript. Or for advertisement is another good example. So if you must, you can use a feature of the content security policy called CSP nonces. What you have to do for that, you have to generate a random value, and then in the content security policy, in the response header, you add this value here, somewhere there, and then this tells the browser all inline script tags need an attribute with the same random value. If they don't have this, it will not be executed. And because this value is random and regenerated on every request, the attacker can't know it. Problem is, this can still be bypassed because very famously there was a blog post a couple months ago about malicious JavaScript NPM packages. Title was, I'm harvesting credit card numbers and passwords from your site, here is how. It's a very nice blog post. The summary of that is basically someone published an NPM package that does weird things and it's included in some libraries and then it's just JavaScript that you serve. And of course, probably nobody checks all JavaScript files they load with NPM and include somewhere. So this is a problem. Next thing is what the attacker can do, he can try to trick the user into providing sensitive information. So not really a security vulnerability there, and most importantly, it's phishing. It's mostly hard to prevent because it's out of your control. If the user goes to a page that you don't control, you can't do anything about this. But there are some attack vectors that are preventable. The first one is called clickjacking. Let's look at this login page. And there is something weird here, if you notice. There is this is like a typo here. So first of all, maybe register typo domains, because oftentimes people use these for sending phishing to users. And then what this page is doing here, it looks legit. There is like a login page and everything. It's actually the login page of this site. The source code of this looks like this. So it's actually an iframe that's included there and some JavaScript. Of course, the JavaScript on the attacker's site can't access anything in the iframe. So they cannot access the session cookie, they cannot access any data in there because the browser prevents that. But what the attacker side can do, it can just put invisible boxes overlaying the iframe there to capture input. That can be passwords, that can be email address, that can be credit card number, anything you can think about. So you should forbid that your page is displayed in an iframe. And you can do this with another response header called xFrameOptions. The value of that can either be deny or same origin, which basically says either this page should never be included in an iframe, or this page should only be included in iframes on the same domain. So this is already good. Another funny thing is called tapnabbing that I stumbled upon. Tapnabbing works like this. So you have a link to an external page, and you open it in a new window with this target blank thing. This is actually very common for links in user-provided content. Think about comments, you put a link in there, you want to link it that other people can click on it, but you want to open it in a new tab, because your application should stay open. The problem with that is that in the opened window, with JavaScript on this page, I have access to a window opener object. I can't access the session cookies, I can't access the DOM, but I can change the location of the page in the tab. So imagine you're on Facebook, you open a link, you click on a link, a new tab opens, there is a video with nice cats, and once the video is finished, I close the tab again, I'm still on a page that looks like Facebook, and it asks me for a password. probably 90% of people would not recognize that the URL is slightly different and would just enter their Facebook password. To prevent that, you have to add an additional attribute to the link, which is called rel no opener. And this will tell the browser, hey, don't make the opening window accessible in the new tab. It's very sad that this is not the default, but unfortunately, you have to add it. You can find more information on this blog post, and there's also like a working example that showcases that you can just click it. I have a couple minutes left, so let's skip a bit ahead. Speaking of URLs and user-generated content, small task, spot the difference. The key is here, this is Cyrillic E. And since a couple years, we have this thing with international domain names. And most browsers and everything else will just use the Unicode representation and will just say, show it as it that the user can read it. It's very easy also to find and get phishing URLs and attacks in there because you think it's Facebook, but it's actually Cyrillic eBook. This is called IDN homographic attack. So if you have a page where users can enter URLs that you link, then maybe analyze these URLs, look at the URL, see if it's just ASCII characters or if it's actually like some Unicode characters in there, and then if it's Unicode characters, since it's very uncommon to use them anyways, especially in Europe and North America, but also in other regions of the world, maybe just warn the user. Tell them, hey, big enough to read. You're about to access this page here, but is this like really this, because this is the ASCII representation of this Cyrillic E, is this like really the page you want to visit? And maybe be cautious, because this is a common attack vector for phishing. What you also can do is you can, if you analyze, so this is like a page, when you click on it, then it goes in between. When you have this already and analyze the links to user-provided content, you also can try to warn on misspellings of your own domain. Because it may look like a page that is under your control, like, for example, the Facebook page, the Facebook profile of another user, but it could actually be a misspelling that is hard to recognize. So, for example, like this, or this is not even a misspelling, this is just like another domain name, or this, if it's really long, then maybe also this attacker.com people don't see anymore. So that could be a solution. Also, if you analyze links and try to find out something about this, also follow redirects. So that if it's a bit.ly link, and then in the end the user will see a Cyrillic E in the address bar, maybe try to recognize this by following redirects, and maybe then cache the result because it may be kind of slow. Also, I have another thing about XSS injections. There is some possibilities where you can try to detect XSS vulnerabilities, which depends a bit on your templating library and if this is possible. For example, if you use Mustache basically takes a template, then has some JavaScript that then does all the escaping and putting in values and renders out HTML. What you can do is every time some value gets escaped, you can also replace a very common character, for example, E. It depends a bit on the language. If E is not common in your language, then maybe do something differently. Also escape the character E with an escape sequence of the user-generated content. And before returning resulting HTML, check if there are any E characters left. like at the end of your rendering process before printing out the HTML to the user. If there are any E characters, then probably there is a potential XSS vulnerability because you forgot to escape something. And then, of course, as a last step, replace the escape sequence back to E so that your content does not look weird. Code example for that. So this is mustache template. It gets a first name and a last name. And then mustache, two curly braces means escape something. Three curly braces means don't escape because it may already be escaped or something. Because it went through HTML purifier or something else. Data for this is Peter Parker. And if we use this approach and the escape sequence is something weird like underscore, 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 101, underscore, 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 then the template that is rendered in the end looks like this. So either it was static content, so I can also replace this, or it was, in this case, for Peter, we escaped it, so we also escaped the E. But for Parker, we didn't do this. And there is still this E in here. And then we can alert on that, and of course replace everything back. And last, let's see, 1 second. Yeah, let's maybe also do that. There's also a nice approach for a bit of phishing that is called self-XSS. Self-XSS is something that works for users that are not really technical, so for my mom, for example, where they get an email and say, hey, to unlock these new great features in your social networking site or to get like new coins in Farmville or whatever, please open the developer tools and pass in this source code there and press enter. You can all imagine what is in there. So maybe if add a console warning to it like this, hey, if you open the console, using this console should only be done if you really know what you're doing. Attackers may use this. Yeah, it's, a developer is annoying to read all the time, but it may prevent this. So, where was I? To sum it up. Yeah, here I will. Let's sum it up. The internet is a very scary place. And if you have any users on your website, you are a potential target for attackers. And just maybe because it's some kid somewhere at home after school and they are bored. So you have to stay alert. It's very good to invest in good security practices. As we, with all the things we talked about. And there is always more. So this is like, as I said, only 2/3 of what I wanted to talk about. So, and it's constantly changing. So you have to stay up to date. Read blog posts, go to talks, go to security calls, because things may change. The slides will be available on SpeakerDeck. So I saw some of you making pictures. You can also have a look at the slides later on and revisit all of that. And there are also links to blog posts and so in this. There are also some more links to resources and some more backup slides. And if you have any questions, we can do this directly after. Or if you don't want to talk to me directly, you can also send me an email, that's possible, or send me a message on Twitter and also answer as soon as possible. Thank you very much. And yeah, any questions, I'm happy to answer them. Yeah, there in the back.
Oh, yeah, no worries. Okay, so so basically, you mentioned that we can use headers to actually prevent some of the attacks. But basically, since all of them are actually modifiable by man-in-the-middle attack, right? Is there actually any real protection except completely disabling HTTP and focusing only on HTTPS?
No. So don't you. Use HTTPS, disable completely HTTP, only do a redirect to HTTPS. That's the only. So since it's free, cheap, so free, and since it's also fast, just do it. Even if you think that your page does not need it because you just, it's a newspaper page or so, It still can be modified. It's still also from a privacy point. In some countries, it may be illegal to view it. So it's also good for customer protection, just encrypted.
Thank you.
Yeah, here in the front, maybe throw it over.
Great. Well, it worked out great. I just wanted to ask you if you know anything about a possible method, like one combined with DNSSEC, to advertise that you are using HTTPS, and if it isn't one, or there isn't one, why?
So, first of all, it's a very good point that also DNS is vulnerable, and I could also hack into the DNS protocol, which is not encrypted, and then redirect the domain name to a different IP address. So that is a big problem already. Fortunately, there is things like DNSSEC or DNS over HTTPS that people are proposing now, so this is in a process of solving. I would need to look this up. If with DNSSEC you can also say do HTTP next as an HTTPS as a next protocol. I actually don't know that. I would need to look this up. Does anyone know?
There was a failed attempt called something like HPKP or something like that, HTTP public key pinning, but it was a failure, definitely. But yeah, I think it should be supplanted with that header thing.
So the first thing is the strict transport security in browser preloading is already fairly good because it covers like the 90% use case of users in browsers. I would need to look this up with directly enforcing HTTPS. Another good thing is HTTP2 because HTTP2 enforces HTTPS in browsers again. So there is no possible way to do HTTP2 without HTTPS. And what we were talking about is HTTP key pinning. That was the thing that you can basically tell the browser, please, this is my certificate, and please remember now for like half a year that this is the only valid certificate so that attackers cannot exchange it. The problem is there are some very good reasons why you would exchange the certificate. And that is, for example, semantic or so. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Good.
Is there some way how to prevent browser extensions to access my data?
Browser extensions to access data, no.
Because it happens to us that...
At least I don't know any, because they are in the browser they can access the DOM. I think it's hard to prevent, and yes, it's also a problem.
So there is no some flag, like...
You could try to detect, if you know the extension that is problematic, you could try to detect it, but... So I don't know if any way, if anyone knows, I would also be interested in that. You're also shaking your head already, okay. Okay, then, yeah, if you have more questions, I'll definitely stick around. Also, I'm going to be here at the party later on and enjoy the rest of the conference. Okay.